तत्परं ह्यय विद्महे ज्ञानलिङ्गेश्वरय धीमहि तन्नो गुरुः प्रचोदयात् ओम योग महर्षि डॉक्टर स्वामी गीतानंद गिरि गुरु महाराज की जय। Today we are looking at our second session on yoga and the spine, or the spine and yoga. And when we are talking of the spine, we are including in it many structures. Because when we talk about the spine, people just make one statement, spine, and no one knows what's happening. So I think we have to be very clear that normally when we talk about the spine, we are talking about a set of vertebrae, and these vertebrae make us a vertebrate as opposed to the invertebrate. And yesterday Anand Raj and I were studying his biology lesson where they are looking at a leech, you know, those leeches that suck blood, and it's an invertebrate. And then you have the chordates, the vertebrates, which is a rabbit. So they are comparing, and I got a lot of information about a leech that I did not know. It has 5 pairs of eyes. Isn't that amazing? Quite amazing, okay? 5 pairs of eyes but no ears. Anyway, I'm not here to give you a lecture on the leech, but I found it interesting. We are a vertebrate, which means we have a vertebral column. And this vertebral column is made up of 33 vertebrae. Okay, so the leech also has 33 segments. I like to find these cross connections because it's very interesting. It also has a mouth and anus, and we also have a mouth and anus, and it has 33 segments. We have 33 vertebrae. So no wonder many human beings are actually leeches. Okay. We have 33 vertebrae making up the vertebral column, which is basically the structure of the spine. So when we say spine, the first part of the structure that we need to understand is that we have 33 vertebrae. These are bones. And these are bones that support our ability to move around. They support the head on top of the whole spine. They enable the rib cage to move freely. And they house in the center. They have a canal in the center. So all of these bones have a canal in the center. So you end up with this canal. And in this vertebral canal, you have the spinal cord, which is the nervous system. So please keep in mind, we need to distinguish. We have a vertebral column that is bone, and then we have a spinal cord that is nerve. Because people get very confused. They talk about the spine and they're talking about the bones, and then suddenly they're talking about the nerves and their bones, and people get very confused. So we need to understand, when we use the term the human spine, we are talking about a vertebral column which has the bony structure, within which there is a hollow canal. The bone has a canal, it's a vertebral canal, within which you have the spinal cord, which is part of your nervous system, especially the most primitive part of your nervous system, which is the reptilian complex. The spinal cord, along with the brain stem, is basically your reptilian complex, which has all the primitive reflexes. So it is very much a reflexive part of you. So when we talk about a spinal cord mentality, and that used to be my father's choicest abuse to people, and there couldn't be a word, worse thing he could call you than a spinal cord mentality, which means you were basically a reptile and you had no cortical functioning at all. You are just instinctively reacting with your reflexes, and because it is up here that you can choose not to do so. But many people are locked in the spinal cord reflexes. So spinal cord is nervous system. The vertebral canal is in the vertebral column, which is your bone, which is your skeletal system. So initially they used to have the muscular separate, skeletal separate. It has become musculoskeletal system. Everything is the same, but it's just to understand it, we split it apart. So in our vertebral column, which has 33 vertebrae, what happens is we have in the neck region, we have 7 cervical vertebrae. And these are thin, a bit flimsy, and quite fragile. And the reason they are thin, flimsy, and fragile is because we need to move our neck in all directions. And for the sake of mobility, they have sacrificed stability. So whenever we look at the body function, we need to understand that for the sake of mobility, the neck bones, the cervical vertebrae, have sacrificed stability for the sake of mobility. Same thing happens with your shoulder joint, where there's more mobility, less stability, compared to the hip joint, where there's more stability, less mobility. And if we start to understand our functioning this way, it is much, much better than trying to learn all the difficult names that don't make sense most of the time, and then just say those names so people think we are very wise. The vertebral column, we have 7, remember 7, cervical vertebrae. We then have 12 thoracic, sometimes also called dorsal vertebrae. So 12 thoracic or dorsal vertebrae that are linked to the 12 pairs of ribs. And yes, it doesn't matter if you're a man or woman, you have 12 pairs. Men do not, I repeat, men do not have one less rib or anything. Both men and women have 12 pairs of ribs. And these 12 pairs of ribs are attached to your vertebral column. That is why the vertebral column plays an important role, because all the 12 pairs of ribs, that's 24 ribs, are attached on the back to the vertebral column. So they're all attached like this. And that is why the ribs can move like this. That is why when we breathe in Vibhaga Pranayama, we breathe front, side, back. And then when we breathe out, back, side, front. Front, side, back. Back, side, front. It is because in the back they are attached to the vertebrae. In the front, they can move the ribs, the 12 pairs of ribs. Okay? The moment I started talking about ribs, I'm going to get all of these male-female issues coming up. Something I try to avoid. Anyway, 12 pairs of ribs, 12 dorsal vertebrae or thoracic. So you have 7 plus 12, 19. Then you have 5 lumbar. In the lumbar region, the lower part of the back, the lower back, which are solid and heavy. These are like the sumo wrestlers. Okay? These are like the sumo wrestlers. They are amazingly, you know, heavy, and they take all the weight down there, because at the bottom, they are carrying everything. So these are the strong guys right down there, 5 of the lumbar vertebrae, 7 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar. You then have 5 sacral vertebrae, which are basically the posterior part, the back of your pelvis. So the pelvis is basically a very nice bowl. It's like a big bowl. And the back of the bowl, the sides of the bowl are basically your hip bones. But the back of the bone, the bowl, is basically your sacrum, which is 5 sacral vertebrae. S1, S2, S3, S4, S5. They are numbered like that. So C1 to C7, T1 to T12, L1 to L5, and then S1 to S5. But all these 5 get fused together. So you have 5 sacral vertebrae, but only 1 sacral bone, 1 sacrum. And then at the tip of it, we have what used to once upon a time be our tail, the rudimentary tail, which is the coccyx. And there are 3 or 4 bones. And these bones, these 4 bones that are down there, they become one bone. So the vertebrae are 4, but they cannot move on their own, because these are rudimentary vestigial structures from when we once upon a time had that tail that could wag. That is why even now, many people, that is the part that they shake when they dance, especially to some of the music, which is very, very primitive. So four coccygeal vertebrae, that become one coccyx, one bone. So at the bottom of the vertebral column, you have one sacrum with five vertebrae and one coccyx with four vertebrae. So what has happened is nine vertebrae have become two bones. You are with me? Fine. 7 plus 12, 19 plus 5, 24. Separate vertebrae, separate bones, 24. Then you have another 9 vertebrae. So 24 plus 9, 33 vertebrae. Remember I told you 33 vertebrae in us, 33 segments in the leech. Yeah. But when it comes to bones, you have only two more. So 24 plus 2 is 26. So 33 vertebrae, 26 bones is what makes up our vertebral column. Now within this vertebral column, you have a vertebral canal in which you have the spinal cord. And now it gets confusing because you have spinal nerves. And these are the nerves that come out of the spinal cord at different areas. So when they come out at the cervical region, they are the cervical nerves. Again numbered C1, but now to C8. So you have 8 cervical nerves. 7 cervical vertebrae, 8 cervical nerves. This is where we have to understand there are some differences there. So these nerves are coming out of the spinal cord at different areas. And because they are related to a similar level of separation in the vertebrae, they get these names. So you have 8 cervical nerves, 12 at the thoracic, the dorsal, 5 at the lumbar. And these are pairs. Now here you have to remember, one goes on the right, one goes on the left. One goes on the right, one goes on the left. One goes on the right, one goes on the left. So you have these pairs. So 31 pairs of spinal nerves, not 31 spinal nerves, 31 pairs of spinal nerves, right and left. 8 cervical, 12 thoracic, so 20, you already have 20. 5 for the lumbar, so 25. 5 at the sacral, 30, and 1 coccygeal. So 8 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral nerves, and 1 coccygeal nerve, making up 31 pairs of spinal nerves. Now, in addition to that, you have a huge set of muscles on the back, paraspinal muscles. And these muscles enable you to stand erect, move, bend forward, bend back. And there are so many muscles that are supporting us. So they are the spinal, paraspinal muscles, the musculature. Then you have blood vessels, the arteries and the veins. Then you have the lymphatics, you have all of this, and then you have the minor nerves running here and there, which means all of this together is one when we use the term the human spine. So when we use the term the human spine, it is all of this together. And that is what I wanted to let you know today. And when we are working with the human spine, we need to realize that it was designed to be on 4 feet, the chatushpada, quadruped. And what happened is, as we started to stand up, modifications came into play and so certain changes came into play. And if you go back to the history of every human being, I'm not talking of human history, every human being's history, we all started by crawling. That is where we started the process. You know, the baby was on the back, it turned over, and then it started to do this swimming action. Because, you know, you remember once upon a time we were all fish, so swimming action, and then it starts to crawl. And as it starts to crawl, it starts to develop all these musculatures. The joints start to develop, the muscles start to develop. And then it gets ready to start to stand up and then to walk. Swamiji used to often ask people, he said, why do babies crawl? And immediately people used to say, because they cannot walk. Babies crawl because they cannot walk. And Swamiji used to say, no, you have got it totally wrong. Babies crawl so that they can walk. So crawling is a precursor to the process of walking. And whenever we are dealing with people who have injuries to the spine, it may be bony injuries, it may be muscular spasms, it could be spinal cord injuries that even can go to the extent of when people have, you know, strokes and other things. One of the very important messages we need to keep from the point of view of yoga and yoga chikitsa or yoga therapy is that we need to get people crawling again. Because when you start to crawl, what you are doing is you are recapitulating in your body the lessons that you went through as a baby when you crawled so that you could go into the process of standing up and walking. So one of the very important rehabilitative practices is crawling around, and we call it Chatushpada Kriya. So let us start doing that a bit, okay? So join me as we come on to all fours, okay? So we are on all fours now. And in this all four position, this is where it's a very good position. For those who have been with me all these days, you know, asanas are basically simulation techniques. You remember, Manjari, you made that note on simulation techniques? Yeah, asanas are simulation techniques, and Manjari loves animals a lot, especially dogs. She's writing a book on that, and I let her announce it. It's her book, but I'm really, really honored to be part of it, Manjari. So if we go on to all fours, suddenly we start to know what it feels like to be on all fours. So may it be cats, or may it be dogs, or any animal. What happens is we start to understand them a bit more. So the Chatushpada, Chatur or Chatush means four, Pada is feet. So we come into a four-foot posture called Chatushpada. Immediately you have negated all the negative effects of gravity. Because now suddenly your spine doesn't have to carry that heavy head of yours, okay? It doesn't have to carry your head weight anymore. Suddenly the spine is free of the weight, and the spine can be, especially the lower part. Remember those sumo wrestlers, those big strong guys at the bottom, the lumbar vertebrae? They are just thanking me right now. They say, thank you, Dr. Ananda, for having some sense after all of that nonsense. Now what we do is we further this. We start to move a bit. So you can crawl forward. Then you can crawl back. Again, you can crawl forward. I always suggest you do it on a soft surface. Doing it on a hard surface may not be good for your knees. But on a soft surface, you could always do it when you get up in the morning or before you go to bed at night. Remind yourself that you need to crawl a bit. And yes, as Dr. Meena has said, crawling is grounding. So true. Because when you come onto this, what it does is it grounds you, not just physically, but also mentally. And you stop having so much of head weight. You know, most people, they are so locked up in the positional anxiety that they're the big boss and they're the big director and, you know, blah, 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 whatever position, president, vice president, chairman, chancellor, vice chancellor, whatever they think they are, the director, head of department, anything, you know, all these positions that we have, and so we think we are very great. What we need to do is come on to all fours like this. The moment you come on to all fours, it is a very good practice to reduce the ego also. So it is a practice where we come down to earth, sort of. So it is a grounding practice. We come down to earth, we connect. If you can do it in your garden on the grass or the sand or the beach, nothing better, because you are connecting yourself with the Mother Earth in a very healthy manner. We have been moving forward and back. What you can also do is you can start to crawl around in a bit of a circle, crawling around as we have social distancing, physical distancing going on, you know, we don't have to worry too much about territorial wars.
But often in classes, if you have too many people in your class and the mats are, you know, next to each other.
When you do this practice, and yes, we do it a lot in our sessions, Gitananda tradition gives a lot of importance to crawling around. And when you have too many people in the same class, you have territorial disputes, you are crawling on my mat. Get off my mat and crawl on yours. You know, that type of stuff. India-Pakistan wars. Yeah, you have things like that basically going on. Israel and Palestine, Australia, New Zealand, England and Australia. You know, it's this cricketing wars we have. Yeah, same type of thing you have. So just moving around, circling around. And when we do this practice, it is amazing actually that virtually every joint in your body, and I'm going to repeat that because you may not have heard me. Every joint in your body virtually gets a good exercise when you do this type of crawling. Because when you crawl, virtually every joint in your body has a chance to come into play and do something at this time. Even if you move your head a bit like this, even those internal joints in your ears, malleus, incus and stapes, even those joints get a chance to do that if you move your head a bit and if you move your shoulder a bit. And then, as you all know, what we like to do is when you're on all fours, you can also have an emotional catharsis. And the emotional catharsis is that you let out all these primitive impulses. You remember those reptilian and mammalian impulses? And so what you go is you go, and you bark at each other. Now, I suggest that you do this in your own privacy so that people don't think you've gone mad. If they already know you are mad, then there's no issue about it. That's the advantage we have. People like me, people, they know we are already mad, so no issues. But you can go like, lull. Or, you know, you could, if you want to be a cat, you can go, meow, meow, meow. Or, you know, again, that dog, lull. Or meow. Or then you can become a very nice tiger. And, and let all those instincts come out. Let go of them. You don't want them in you anymore. Yeah, you are now human, okay? You are at least supposed to be human. So letting all of those out, at the same time, your spine is getting a chance to be in a neutral position. The different joints are being used nicely. And you can even be a nice lion and go, and get all those old instincts out as you move around. An amazing practice, wonderful practice. Crawling, I cannot overemphasize it. Crawling is one of the best things you can do for yourself. And especially if you're helping people recover after trauma, injury, and trying to come back to the feet. I think if you have people who are trying to come back to the feet, this is a very, very useful practice. Never underestimate the power of crawling. The power of crawling is amazing because it grounds you physically, mentally, emotionally. It enables a little bit of this head weight to come down and you stop. You know, I think one of the best things, people have a lot of hypertension. And most of the time the hypertension is because they are constantly getting offended because they think too much of themselves. You never give offense, you always take offense. And why do you take offense? Because you think too much of yourself. Don't you know who I am? How dare you say that to me? And what happens is our blood vessels start to constrict. The moment we get into that, we're like, don't you know who I am? And your blood pressure has gone up, not somebody else's. You know, as they say, you know, being angry at somebody and hoping them to get hurt is like, you know, you holding on to a hot burning coal and thinking somebody will get burnt by it. Your anger burns you. Your negative emotions burn you, nobody else. And if you take offense, your blood pressure goes up and you are going to have hypertension leading to a stroke and a heart attack, and God help you. Rest in peace. What is very important is to realize that most of the time, people are just saying hello. And we are in such a state, we say, how dare you say hello to me? or somebody smiles at you and say, you know, what do you think? You think that, you know, I look like I'm funny that you're smiling at me? No. It is so important for us to let go of this false sense of asmita. Yesterday, I was listening to my dear yoga brother, Kaustub, who gave a beautiful chanting session. He gives a session at 11 a.m. And his session was on the Shiva Tandava Stotra, which is composed on Lord Shiva by Ravana, the Asura, king of Lanka, who is the villain in the Ramayana, but actually quite an amazing guy in his own way. And many versions of the Ramayana in India, we have 40-50 versions. There are versions where Ravana is the good guy. Especially, you find a lot of people in South India, especially Tamil Nadu, called Ravana. Ravanan is a common thing. Okay, so Ravana composed this. But coming back, Kaustubh was talking about this and he mentioned the word asmita and split the word as asmita. Smita means to smile, and asmita, that ego that prevents us from smiling. I think it's an amazing understanding of what ego is. Asmita. Smita is to smile. When can you smile? When you are at ease with yourself. When you are at ease with the situation around you, you can smile. If you are not at ease with yourself and you are not at ease with the situation around you, you're not going to smile unless you have a psychiatric illness. And that's a different story. And yes, as was pointed out, this is very useful in psychiatric illnesses. And so many of our patients at CITER who have mental issues, you put them into the crawling, have them make the sound. I tell you, it is such a healthy way to regain sanity. We are going to continue this work as we go. Remember, 33 vertebrae, 26 bones, 31 pairs of spinal nerves, all the muscles, the blood vessels, the lymphatics making up the spine. And the first thing we need to do is get rid of a bit of the head weight, take the weight off the spine. And so we go into the crawling position, Chatushpada Asana, which is the four-footed posture, and Chatushpada Kriya, which is when we crawl around. When you're crawling, make sure you have a soft surface so that you don't harm your knees. Other than that, everybody can do it. And especially people who are in rehabilitation, people who are recovering from injuries or post-surgery, people who want to get back onto their feet, please get them crawling. It is one of the best ways. And my father, when he was in his mid-70s, had that accident. He had that accident, broke his spine. And one of the most important aspects of his recovery was the crawling. So do not think that crawling is a simple thing. And so why should I do it? I need to do all these complicated, funny sounding pranayamas and funny sounding asanas and twist myself into a pretzel. Nah, all of that is for those who want that. What we need is often very, very simple. What we need is often, it has to be digestible. When you want to learn, you have to get stuff in a digestible form. Then inside you can assimilate it and it becomes complex. Always the complex foodstuffs are broken down in the process of digestion into the smallest units. For example, carbohydrates are broken down into monosaccharides. Proteins are broken down into amino acids in order for you to digest them. Then in you, that monosaccharide, that amino acid can then build up something. That is a different issue. But you do not directly digest a whole potato. That doesn't happen. It has to be broken down, a whole banana. When you chew your peas and, you know, eat them and get your protein from your sprouts, please remember, it has to be digestible. So the practices we often need are very simple practices. So do not get taken away by the thing, oh, this is so simple, it cannot be effective. Most probably, the simplest practices are the most effective. These so-called complicated practices are just for another aspect of our development. So do not ever get confused or dissuaded or misuaded, that's a new word, by this. Keep it simple. Keep it understandable. Keep it digestible. And that is the way you grow. So meet you again for some more discussions on the spine and yoga. We have looked at Chatushpada Asana and Kriya today, an amazing practice. Keep crawling. And as you crawl, you get rid of all those animal, subhuman tendencies, and you can start to grow into your human capacities. May you be blessed.